It was. It was very memorable. I did enjoy it.
No, you already have fired.
It was just overnight, Friday to Saturday. Everybody's.
And Gators. They destroyed me.
No, they'll take you. If you let them, they'll take you. They're only too happy to do that.
You're not in the water.
No, we're right next to the water.
Good. For the first song, I'm going to intro with the Heidelberg Catechism.
Okay.
Or playing out for it. No. Something else.
Okay.
But if you could just hit four.
Four.
Oh, I mean, you like song. Yeah, when I'm talking. Yeah, I'm good.
And then the rest of the songs are just let them fade out.
Yep, that's it.
That's great. That's a step forward.
Is that improving?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, just a little step.
Baby steps.
What's up?
What happened? What is your step forward?
I'm going to bring my own brand.
All right, who's doing 2 minutes? 2 minutes?
Goals.
Where's the trivia?
If you, just unmute your mic. You can do it.
2 minutes.
Big game
tonight.
Are these
yours? He's a little nervous about it.
Basically. Good. Yeah, so you see him? Yeah, I'm
going to hit him. He's
there. Do you want to try? Yeah, I try. I don't have one.
That's why you put it over there?
It's too much money.
Yeah.
So I watched it like a few egg thing, which works really good. And it's pretty good quality.
Okay.
But, yeah, but we're, if we're home by the time, I'll turn. I wonder if it's at 5:56.
Being in
the
end.
It's at 5, so yeah,
it
might be
early.
What? That's what basketball, American football.
I need
to get to the first time. It's against the Indiana Pacers. But we're right there next to them. We're
not
being in the playoffs, so they're half a game ahead of us. So we win, we'll be half a game ahead of them.
Oh, okay, perfect.
We'll get you out of there.
We're in like 5 games left.
I know, I saw a little graph and you were like...
Yeah.
There
you go. That's it. Welcome, guys.
We should get a little loop. 2 minutes?
Yeah.
Like a little buddy just hit.
Yeah.
That's
you know what's fun?
And I've heard other teams do it. We're not going over to that. I've watched games away games and they tell the same thing.
Oh really?
Yeah, they don't say no speed noodles, they say I can't see the heat, but what's the heat record? We're half a game, right? No, no, no. Top 18 make the playoff. But you wanna be these teams here, they gotta do like a plane, like connect the knees. You gotta play to make the playoff. But you wanna be here. Against each other. You fight for the last 2 spots. Those 4 teams. We don't want to do that. We just want to be in the playoffs and get some rest.
Get some rest.
Alright, ready guys?
Good morning and welcome to South Kendall Community Church. It is great to see everyone here today on a Sunday after Easter. We're praising God for another Sunday in God's house. I know some of you have seen, been watching the news, we've been talking a lot about a solar eclipse. Can we put the picture up, Mama? And so tomorrow, I guess, we're not only going to see partial of the solar eclipse. But then I was kind of thinking about the solar eclipse, and everybody talking about the solar eclipse, that, and I thought, does everybody know that there's another solar eclipse that's coming? Look at this passage in the Bible about when Jesus returns, when it says in Revelation 21:23. This is talking about the heavenly Jerusalem coming down. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine in it. Why is that? For the glory of God gives its light, and the Lamb is its lamp. Think about that for a moment. That in the new heavens and the new earth that are coming, that we are going to enjoy the light of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit forever. We won't need that sign. We've got the brightness of Jesus in us, over us, and around us. So we're thankful to God for this promise. Amen. So we got a great Sunday lined up for us. If this is your first time visiting with us, I want to say welcome. We're so thankful to God that you took that step of faith to come and join us today. We know it would be a little intimidating coming to a brand new place. We want to invite you to just make yourself at home here with the family of God. If you see us stand, we want to invite you to stand with us. If you see us pray with us. If you see us open God's Word, sing with us. And it's going to be a great service. Today, if this is maybe your first Sunday back after some time, I want to say welcome back. It's great to see you, and we always want to come to those who are tuning in on our live stream. We're thankful that God led you to this link. And if you do live here in the Miami area, we would love to meet you in person if you're able to right here next Sunday at 10 a.m. So today is the first Sunday of the month, which means that we're going to be celebrating the Lord's Supper at the conclusion of today's sermon. And then after church, we're going to go next door in the community center and celebrate all of our April birthdays. We're going to have a celebration next door after church. But today, we're going to be opening God's Word, and we're going to be looking in the book of Romans. Book of Romans. I don't know if some of you may remember last year we looked at Romans, but we only looked at chapters 1 through 4. This year, we're going back into Romans and we're going to look at chapters 5 through 8. The greatest passages in God's Word are found right there in Romans chapter 5 through 8. So today we're looking at Romans 5, and we're looking at the access that we have to the Father through the Son, Jesus Christ. So that's what we've got to have. To look forward to in today's service. Okay? A couple things to celebrate in church, a couple pictures of the week. First of all, was Easter Sunday. How many of you were here our last Sunday for Easter Sunday? Wasn't that a great time? Praising God and the Lord,
Look at the buttons.
Almost 300 people next door in the community center. I told somebody, I said, I think somebody was multiplying the bread and fish in stores. I don't know how we fed so many people there, but God was faithful. And so we're thanking God for that new celebration last Sunday. The youth group took a camping trip on Friday night. They came back yesterday. And good news to report, all the children returned on the trip.
We're sound alive.
I saw a couple try to wrestle some alligator.
It's all for the
actually about Jesus and serving the Lord here in this place. All right, let's take a moment and prepare our hearts to worship God. I know that on this day, some of you may be coming in being weighed down by some kind of burden, maybe over something that's happened this past week. Maybe anxious about something that could be coming up in this coming week. But we're here today, and Jesus is present with us. So I want to invite everybody here. Let's take a moment just quietly in our pews to just close our eyes, bow our heads, to humble ourselves before the Lord. If there's something that you need to surrender, surrender it. If there's something you need to confess, confess it, and ask God to prepare you as we worship God this morning. Father God, we are here as your people to shout for joy for knowing that we are in your presence this morning. And we're also here to kneel before you in humility, Lord. We come before you in reverence and in awe, understanding that you gave us your Son, Jesus Christ, that Jesus bore the cross, he beat the grave, and it's through his victory that we are here to celebrate this new life in Christ. So we ask you, Lord, this morning that you will fill our hearts with the Holy Spirit as we seek to worship you in the way Jesus called us to worship you in spirit and in truth. And we hold on to the promise that the Lord made to his followers when he said, when two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. And all of God's people agreed and said,
Amen. Praise God. If you're able to stand, please stand as we prepare to worship our Lord, who is from everlasting to everlasting. Our call to worship is from Psalm 95. It's going to be a responsive reading. If we can go to the first slide, I'm going to read the part that's in white that's on top, and I'm going to ask everybody to read the part that's in yellow that's on the bottom. Can we practice it together? It says, "For he is our God, we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care." Wow, a lot of you sound like it's the Sunday after Easter. But we're celebrating the resurrection of Jesus today, okay, as well. Amen? Let's try that one more time. "For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care." Amen. People of God, receive the greeting of the Lord. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God the Father and the faithful Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Psalm 95 says this: "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song.
For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care.
For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. For the sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker." Let's say it together nice and loud. "For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care." Amen. Remain standing for song.
This song is based off of a document that was compiled by the church a long time ago, that was meant to instruct people what the truths of the gospel were. And the very first thing that it addresses is this. I wanted to share it with you guys. It says, it was a series of questions and answers. It was called the Heidelberg. It says, "What is your only comfort in life and in death?" And it says, "That I am not my own, that I belong body and soul in life and in death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ, who has fully paid for my sins with his precious blood and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil." And so this song celebrates this truth this morning. If you've never heard it, we're going to go through the verse real quick just so you guys can get it, and then we'll sing it together as a group. It sounds like this.
You are my peace in life and in death. You comfort me with your love and mercy. I know I don't deserve your love, but Lord, you've shown the depths of your love for me. Lifted high on that tree, and your blood spilled for me. The Father's wrath satisfied. You died to make me free. And my only comfort in life and in death is to know I belong to you. Adopted by the ruler of creation, not because of what I've done, but because of his love. My only comfort in life and in death is to know I belong to you. Adopted by the ruler of creation, not because of what I've done, but because of his love.
You are my peace.
You are my peace. In life and in death, comfort me with your love and mercy. I know I don't deserve your love, Lord. You've shown the depths of your love for me. Lifted high on that tree, because of what I've done, but because of His love. And nothing can separate me from the love of Jesus Christ. And nothing can separate me from the love of Jesus Christ. And nothing can separate me from the love of Jesus Christ. And nothing can separate me from the love of Jesus Christ. My only comfort, life and in death, is to know I belong to You. Adopted by the ruler of creation, not because of what I've done, but because of His love. My only comfort, life and in death, is to know I belong to You. Adopted by the ruler of creation, not because of what I've done, but because of His love.
Oh, Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus knows it's the victory.
By my side, the Savior, he will stay.
praise God. I was watching Paul play with five strings instead of six strings. And I thought, as I was watching that, I thought, you know what? That sometimes we've only got five strings. But if we only got five strings, does that stop us from praising God? I think actually God gets more glory when it's just five strings. Because when we're weak, he's strong. Amen? Let's take our Bibles and go to James chapter 1. We're going to read this passage as a way to prepare our hearts for today's sermon, but also to prepare for our congregational prayer. And this is the first Sunday of the month, so this is the congregational prayer where I actually give you all an opportunity to join me in praying. Maybe there's somebody that God has placed on your heart. Maybe they're going through a difficult time. Maybe this individual is distancing themselves from the Lord. I don't know what's going on with that person, but God put that person in your heart. It may be a daughter, maybe a son, maybe a father, maybe a mother, maybe a relative, maybe a coworker. I don't know who the person is. But when I get to that point in the prayer and I say, Lord, hear the prayer of your people, if you would just invite you to say that person's name out loud. And as you say that person's name out loud, know that as you pray for them, we're praying with you for that individual as well, okay? So we're looking at James chapter 1, and we're going to go from verses 1 through 12. And God's word says this: James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes scattered among the nations, verse 2. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Verse 5. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all they do. Verse 9. Believers in humble circumstances ought to take pride in their high position. But the rich should take pride in their humiliation, since they will pass away like a wildflower. For the sun rises with the scorching heat and withers the plant. Its blossom falls and its beauty is destroyed. In the same way, the rich will fade away even while they go about their business. Verse 12. Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. This is the word of the Lord. Would you bow your heads in prayer with me this morning? Father, we turn to you with hearts full of praise, acknowledging that our joy is in Christ, that he is our living hope. Lord, I ask you to forgive us for the times that we have doubted your presence and doubted your goodness in our lives. Forgive us for the times that we've allowed the dark clouds to position themselves in a place in our hearts where they block the light of your Son. But thank you, God, for the gift of repentance that you give to us, that enables us to turn away from our sin. And thank you for the gift of faith that you give to us, that enables us not just to turn away from our sin, but to turn to Christ as our Savior. Thank you, Lord, that through your grace, you compel us to keep coming back to Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the ministry of intercession that you've given to us. that we can come to you with the things that weigh heavy on our hearts. But we can also present to you the requests and the petitions of our brothers and sisters who are going through a difficult time as well. And so, Father, at this time, I ask that you will hear the prayers of your people. Father, we are not just praying for these people, but we are pleading on behalf of these individuals that you will do your work in your time in their lives. Give us wisdom, Lord, as we navigate through the complexities of this life. We need that Holy Spirit wisdom to know when to say yes and when to say no and when to speak and when to be silent, even in our dealings with these individuals that we are praying for. Father, I pray that this new month that you've given us, the month of April, will be a month where you provide for the needs of our church through the generosity of your people. May this be a month, Lord, where we seek your kingdom first, and then we step back and watch how you cause all things to fall in their proper place. Prepare our hearts to receive your word, Lord. Yes, it is true that the grass withers and the flower fades, Lord, but remind us this morning that your word stands forever. Forgive the sins of the speaker, for they are many, and may we see Jesus and him only this morning. And we pray this in Christ's name. And all of God's people agreed and said, amen. Amen. Praise God. At this time, I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward as we prepare to collect our offering this Sunday morning. And you see the QR code up there. If you scan that on your phones, that'll take you to a page on our website with instructions on how to give electronically. The passage for today, our stewardship passage of today and of this week, is 2 Corinthians 8:7, which says this: "But just as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in your love for us, see that you also excel in this grace of giving." Amen. At this time, we'll collect our offering. And we'll ask our children, 4 years old to fifth grade, if your parents say it's okay, your grandparents say it's okay, we've got a special class for you next door in the community center. And as our children are going out, I direct your attention up to the screen so you see some of the announcements of events taking place at the church. Let's take our Bibles and go to Romans chapter 5. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 11. So if you don't have a Bible with you, I want to invite you to just reach out and grab that blue Bible in the pew in front of you. We're on page 914. We also translate the sermon in Spanish simultaneously every Sunday morning. So the ushers are going around with Spanish Bibles and translation devices for people who need that. And we're on page 749 in the Spanish Bibles, 749 en las Biblias en Español. All right, Romans. How many of you are ready for Romans? Let's go. Many have called this the greatest letter ever written in human history, and we get to study it, and it's in God's Word. So I invite you to stand. If you're able to stand, I'm going to read verses 1 through 11. Our title for today's sermon is The Access of the Gospel. I'm reading from the New International Version, and God's Word says this. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. Verse 6, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. Verse 8, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Verse 11. Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. So today we're beginning a new study in the book of Romans, and the title to our study is The Power of the Gospel. The truth is, this study that we're doing this year is actually a continuation of the study we began last year at this time. It was last year in April that we started a study in Romans, and at that time we looked at chapters 1 through 4, preaching two sermons in each of the chapters. Well, this year we're going to do the exact same thing, but we're going to move forward to the next four chapters, and we're going to look at chapters 5 through 8, preaching two sermons in each chapter, except when we get to Romans chapter 8, where I'm going to preach three sermons. Now you might ask, Pastor, why are you going to preach three sermons instead of two in Romans chapter 8? And all I can say is, wow, okay? Wait till we get to Romans chapter 8. As a matter of fact, that song we were singing about my only comfort in life, I told Carrie, I said, we got to sing that when we get to the end of Romans chapter 8. Nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord, okay? So this is what we've got. We got our lineup here for the next 9 weeks in Romans. So today we're going to start with the first one, which is the access of the gospel. Let me show you where we get this idea of the access of the gospel. It's in Romans chapter 5, verse 2. It says this, through whom, can we say it together, we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Now, I don't know about you, but one of the most frustrating things for me living in a digital age is when I get to this screen. How many of you have ever visited a website or a page that maybe you're trying to log on to a particular website, maybe you're trying to access a particular app, or you're trying to pay a bill? Okay, you want to pay it, but what's the problem? You don't remember what your password is. Okay, how many of you know what I'm talking about, right? And then the chances that in that moment you're going to put a password that you're going to remember later is very, very minimal. Okay, so it might be that you're not saving it on your phone, or you're not picking the right password. That's why you're forgetting it. Okay, so I'm going to give you like a smart life tip this morning. Okay, So what I figured out, this is several years ago, is that if I just use my favorite Bible verses as my passwords, it works. Think about it. Let's take, for example, Genesis 1:1. You got a capital letter. You got more than eight what would you call them, characters. You have a number, and you got a symbol. So what I do is I just have about my three favorite Bible verses. So you got to remember what, you got to know what they are, and I just use them in rotation. So inevitably, it's going to be one of those three for me to gain access to the account or whatever it is that I'm trying to do. But let me show you a passage of the Bible that I want to strongly recommend for you for it to be one of your passwords to the accounts that you access. And it's Romans 5:2. Look at it again. Through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. So I'm recommending to you Romans chapter 5, verse 2. You want to know why? Because as you're gaining access to that account here on earth, you're going to remember that it's through Jesus that you can gain access to the Father in heaven. Amen? And here's the great thing. If we all use the same password, then we can access each other's bank account and make withdrawals whenever we need it. Amen? I'm only joking. Okay? But you get the idea. Romans chapter 5, verse 2. So what I want to show you in today's sermon are three things that our faith in Jesus Christ gives us access to. So what we're going to see through Romans 5, 1 through 11 is how the grace of God at work in us, giving us faith in Christ, gives us access to Christ's work in the past. Number two, Christ's work in the present. And then number three, it grants us access to Christ's work in the future. All right? Does everybody understand what we're going to cover today? So let's start with the first one. Let's look at how our faith in Jesus gives us access to Christ's work in the past. Let's go back up to verses 1 and 2. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Now, I know we're kind of jumping into chapter 5, but it's important to understand a little bit of what Paul's been doing for us in chapters 1 through 4. So if we go back to chapters 1 through 4, what we're going to see is that the Apostle Paul has taken us out of the pit of sin or out of the valley of sin, and he has brought us up all the way to the mountaintop of the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what he's done. And in those four chapters, he touches different themes and different teachings that he now is revisiting in Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. Okay? Let me give you an example. So here he's talking about being justified through faith. Let me show you what he talks about in Romans 3. Romans 3, verse 23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Jesus, by Christ Jesus." Do you see? He's in 5, he's repeating these themes he's talked about earlier here in chapter 3. Now, look at the valley of sin. Look at the pit of sin. What does it look like? Because here it says that we all have sinned, and as a result of our sin nature and our sinful acts, we fall short of what? We fall short of God's glory. In other words, we, no matter how hard we try, no matter how many good works we try to do, we cannot reach up to the glory of God. And the reason for that is because God says to us, "Be holy as I am holy." And no one can be, it's not humanly possible to be as holy as God is holy. Therefore, we all fall short of God's glory. That's the bad news. But the good news is that the message of the gospel is that God did for us, through Jesus, what we could not do for ourselves. So we could not reach up to the Father, bad news. Good news is God reached down to us by giving us his Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, who rose from the grave. And if we believe that Jesus is our Savior, The Bible says that we are declared as justified before God. And this word justified is a term that comes from the court of law. We got lawyers in here. So this is something you're going to totally identify with. So it's like we're the defendant. There's a case that's been brought against us. All of the evidence has been presented. These are sinful people. Where I'm a sinful person, we're sinful people. By the way, the great thing about being a Christian, we don't have to pretend not to be. We're all sinful. Okay? But the evidence that's been presented is not just the fact that we're sinful, but it's that Christ is perfect. Christ is holy. And that he took our place. So the judge in the case, which is the Father, reviews and examines all the evidence, and then he declares a verdict over us. And the verdict that he declares over us because of our faith is in Christ is that we are not guilty before God for the wrong things that we've done. That's what it means to be justified. Look again in verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So the question is, whose good works make us justified before God? Is it our good works? Does our good works make us not guilty before God? I'm asking you. It's not, because we're not justified through our works. It's the instrument that God uses is our faith in Christ and in the good works that Jesus accomplished for us, and that's how we get justified. And that's how we are granted access to the finished work of Christ on the cross and the fact that he conquered the grave. What he did on the cross and what he did through that grave now gets applied to our account, because we're not trusting in ourselves for our salvation. We're trusting in Jesus Christ as our Savior. Amen? So faith becomes the instrument by which what Jesus has accomplished in the past now gets applied to our account. And we are now declared as not guilty, and we have received the justification that Jesus Christ came to bring us. Number one. The second thing that our faith in Christ gives us access to is Christ's work in the present. Let me show you what he talks about when he refers to Christ's work in the present. Look at what it says in verse number 3 and 4. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. Now, I bring up the fact that Christ is at work in the present because I think sometimes in the church, we can focus so much on what Jesus has done in the past. What he did on the cross. I mean, every Sunday, we're talking about Jesus on the cross, Jesus rising from the grave. Basically, every Sunday, you're hearing the same thing. But I think sometimes, if we're not careful, we can turn Christianity into what Jesus has done in the past, but we don't really understand as a result of that over, not an overemphasis, but our emphasis on that, that we don't fully understand how Jesus is at work in the present. This is what we need help in understanding. How is Jesus at work in my life right now? August 7, 2024. So what this passage teaches us is that Jesus is actively using something in our lives to shape and mold us to be the people that God wants us to be. So as you look at this passage, what is it that Jesus is actively, intentionally, and purposefully using to shape and to mold us to be the people that God wants us to be? What is it? It's on the first line and it's in red. You can't get it wrong. He is using the suffering that we experience in our lives to make us who he wants us to be. Now, the suffering that we experience in this life, it can be a physical suffering. It could be an emotional suffering. It could be a relational suffering. It could be a spiritual suffering that we could be experiencing for our faith in Christ. What I want you to know, whatever it is that you are suffering through right now in your life, Jesus is at work behind the scenes trying to accomplish something in your life. And according to this passage, How is Jesus using our suffering? What is he seeking to accomplish in our lives? What does it say? Oh, and before I go there, let me bring up a couple things. So suffering refers to any affliction, any distress, or any pressure we may be experiencing. The other thing I want to know, too, is that notice in the first line, he says, but we rejoice in our sufferings. And you're like, oh, I must be reading this wrong. What he meant to say, we rejoice in our victories, right? Well, what is he talking about that we're rejoicing in our sufferings? It's because of what Jesus is seeking to accomplish in our lives through our sufferings. Let's look at that. What is Jesus intending to produce in us through the difficult trials and tribulations we go through this life? What is it? It's the P word. What is it? He's trying to produce what in us? Perseverance. Perseverance means two Greek words coming together. It means under and it means to remain. To remain under, which can also, in the end, means to endure to the end. For us to cross the finish line in faith. I want to show you three metaphors that the Bible uses to describe the Christian life. You can take a picture of this. I encourage everybody to study these this week. So the Bible compares the Christian life to a race. The Bible compares the Christian life to a fight. The Bible compares the Christian life to a battle. And what's the only way for us to finish the race that's been set out before us? What's the only way for us to fight the good fight? What's the only way for us to stand firm when the day of evil comes? Is if our lives are empowered by a Holy Spirit perseverance. That's the only way it's possible. Look at how God moves in mysterious ways. Because anybody would think, right? So if suffering is something I want to avoid, but suffering is something that God wants to use. God wants to use the suffering we're going through, the hardships, the distress, the afflictions we're going through to produce perseverance in our lives. And let me show you what perseverance produces. The next one, verse 4. Perseverance produces what? What's the C word? Produces character. What does character mean? It means maturity in the faith. That as we endure through hard times, it makes us more mature in Christ. Because we're trusting in him at a greater level. So the more suffering we experience, the more perseverance we have, and the more character we have. Does that make sense? Because, I mean, to me, from a human perspective, we would say, no, it's the exact opposite. The more we suffer, the more we'll become angry. The more we'll become bitter. The more we'll become resentful. The more we'll hate God. The more we suffer. But that's because that would be the result if you're looking at your suffering without the eyes of faith. But if you look at your suffering through the eyes of faith, then you say, no, no, no. God is at work. God is still present. God is going somewhere with this. God is using this to shape me and to mold me to become more like Jesus Christ. Amen? Is this making sense or is it not making sense? We got to have another resurrection in this place. So look at it. Suffering, God is using to produce, what's the P word? Perseverance. And the perseverance that God creates in us generates the C word, which is what? Character. And now let's go to the next thing it produces. And character, what's the last word, the H word? Hope. It's hope. Okay, we're going to talk about hope in just a second when we get to the third point. But let's just kind of review, right? So our faith in Jesus as our Savior grants us access to, number one, Christ's work in the past. That work on the cross, that work in the empty grave, so that through faith now, that work gets applied to my life, and God doesn't see my sin, he sees the righteousness of Christ, and as a result, I'm declared as not guilty and justified before God. Then secondly, it gives me access to what Jesus is actively, purposefully, intentionally doing in my life today, which we can summarize as his work of sanctification, where he's purifying me. He is setting me apart, using my suffering to make me more and more like Jesus. And let's just go for number three. It also gives me access to God's work in the future, which is the glorification that's coming. And we talk about glorification is when Jesus Christ comes back, we will become just like him with our resurrected bodies. So what happened to him in the grave has been promised that will happen to us in the future. Look what he says in verse 5. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. So what is hope? Let me give you a good definition. Hope is a confident expectation in God's promises. That if God said he's going to do something, we have the confidence that he's going to do it in his time. Amen? But I ask the question, why is our hope secure? Like, I know what he did in the past. I can see what he's doing in the present. But how are we assured of that we're going to get to experience what he's promised to do for us in the future? And this is where the Apostle Paul, under the direction of the Holy Spirit, does something incredible. I want to show you how he convinces us that our future is secured in Jesus. Watch what he does in verses 6 through 8. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Why is our future in Jesus secure? We got to answer this question. When was it that Jesus died for us? Did he die for us when we were godly or ungodly? Did he die for us when we were sinners or when we were saints? What do you think? No, he died for us when we were still ungodly in God's eyes. When we were still sinners in God's eyes. That's when he demonstrated his love for us. And in verse 7 he says, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person. Though for a good man, someone might possibly dare die. It's like the Batman thing. Like, I'm not going to kill you, but I don't have to let you live either. But Jesus dies for us while we're still ungodly, while we're still sinners. So watch what he says in 10 and 11. For if when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now have received reconciliation. So if Jesus died on the cross and rose from the grave while we were still God's enemies, then what can we expect God to do for us now that we are saved? Now that we're his family? Now that we're members of his household? Now that we're citizens of his kingdom? Imagine if he did this for us when we were sinners, what could he do for us now that we are saints in Christ? That's why he says what he says in verse 9. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? What I'm telling you, Paul's telling us, it's guaranteed our future is secure in Jesus. Why is no one getting excited about this? Your future is secure in Jesus. It's guaranteed that when Jesus Christ comes back, we don't have to be afraid. We don't have to be afraid at the second coming of Jesus, because Jesus isn't coming to bring judgment to his people. He's coming to bring salvation for us. All right, let's review. What's our favorite new password now? What is it? Romans, just imagine the whole church, we had the same password. What can happen? So it's Romans 5:2, right? Because it's teaching us that through our faith in Christ, we've now gained access to the riches that can be found in Christ. We've gained access to what? His work in the what? In the past, which is his work of what? Justification. What does justification mean? We are now declared as not guilty before God. Those transgressions have been removed as far as the east is from the west. But it's not just access to the work in the past of Jesus. We also have been granted access to what? Christ's work in the what? In the present, today. And what is Christ actively doing in the present? It's his work of sanctification. And what is God using to make us more sanctified in Jesus? He's using our sufferings to produce what? The P word, perseverance, which produces the C word, which is what? Character, and then produces what? Hope, which then leads us that we have now been granted access to Christ's promised work in the future. Which is what? That one day we're going to be what in Christ? We're going to be glorified in Christ. That we will become, when we see him face to face, we are going to become just like him. So if we've been granted access to Christ's work in the past, Christ's work in the present, Christ's work in the future, how should we live our lives today? How? Just look at it. I'm going to put it up here. I'm not going to tell you the answer. You tell me the answer. Christ's work in the past. Not only is this so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Christ's work in the present. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. Christ's work in the future. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. How should we, as followers of Jesus Christ, respond to the fact that we have been granted access to his work in the past, his work in the present, his work in the future? How should we respond? Rejoice. By rejoicing. Our hearts should be filled with joy. This word can also be translated as to boast in the Lord. Because I have been granted access to the work of Christ, past, present, and future, I no longer boast about what I've accomplished in my life. No. I now boast and I brag and I tell other people, let me tell you how good my God is. Let me tell you what my Savior has done for me in the past, what my Savior is doing for me in the present, and what my Savior has promised to do for me in the future, and all of God's people said. Amen. Let's bow our heads as we prepare our hearts to partake of communion. So God's word calls us to examine ourselves, to undergo a spiritual cross-examination with Jesus, where we listen to this calling from God, and then we look in the mirror and we ask, where is my living not matching up to my calling? And then what does it look like for me to repent before God, to ask him to forgive me, and to ask him to make me a restored ambassador for Jesus Christ? That's what it means for us to examine ourselves and to prepare ourselves to come to this table. So let's take a moment, all of us here. Let's take a moment. If there's something we need to confess, let's do business with God as we come to the table this morning. I'm going to ask our elders to come forward as well. Father, what a humbling and joyous reminder to hear that though we fell short of your glory, Jesus descended, then resurrected, and then ascended again, and is coming back one day. For us, Father, fill our hearts with rejoicing. If we boast, may we boast in the Lord. Minister to us as we partake of this bread and cup. We come hungering and thirsting for righteousness. And we know you will fill us. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I was thinking about the communion table, and I thought, you know, and God gave us this table because it testifies to us of Christ's work in the past, right? But it also encourages us in Christ's work in the present because we're doing this in remembrance of him. Like, we're in the present remembering what he's done for us in the past. And then we also eat this bread and drink this cup until when? Until he returns. So it's like past, present, and future all right here at this table. So we've heard God's word. We've heard that he's good. Now we're going to taste and see that the Lord is good, okay? So this is a family meal. If you can say that God is your Father, Jesus is your Savior and your brother, and that the Holy Spirit is your power, we invite you to come and to partake. In a moment, our elders are going to set up right here on either side of the sanctuary at these two tables. And as you come forward, just hold your hands open and receive the bread and receive the cup, and you can partake of communion right up here in the front and then return to your seat. The Apostle Paul said these words in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. But before we do that, let's recite the Apostles' Creed together, which reminds us of who the Father is, who the Son is, who the Holy Spirit is, and who we are because of who God is. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Apostle Paul said this, "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you, that on the night that Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Then the Bible says that after supper, Jesus took the cup, and he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Drink this in remembrance of me." And then Jesus summed it up by saying, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he returns." Our elders can come forward. If there's anybody here who's physically unable to come forward, if you would just raise your hand and then we can bring the communion elements to you, okay? Thank you. I invite you to stand if you're able to stand for our final song.
We got our string back. All right, let's close out this worship service with just a shout of praise, thanking God for the access that he's given to us by faith into this grace in which we now stand. Let's praise him. Here's our favorite part.
And I know how the story ends. We will be with you again.
Amen.
You're my savior, my defense. No more fear. Thank you.
morning. Praise God for another beautiful Sunday. So grateful for the perseverance and hope that he gives us. So we're so happy to have you here this morning at South Kendall Community Church. If you're in need of prayer, anyone in here, whether you've been coming for a long time or today's your first day, we would love to pray with you. So feel free to scan that QR code. Every Tuesday, our church leaders get together and pray over every single prayer request. You can also send any prayer request to prayers@southkendallcc.org. Birthday Sunday! Who has an April birthday? Anyone? Woo! 1, 2, 3. Can I get a 4? No, I'm joking. Okay, 4. Okay, awesome. So super, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord for those birthdays. So we'd love to invite you over to our community center at the conclusion of this service for some cake, free cake. Don't miss out. Okay. Graduation Sunday, so we're super excited. This year, Graduation Sunday will be on Sunday, May 12th, which is also Mother's Day. So excited to celebrate everyone. So if you are a graduating senior, feel free to email South Kendall's email address to let us know, specifically if you're graduating high school. So if you're graduating at all, we'd love to have you and celebrate you, but if you're specifically graduating high school, please send an email so we can prepare a little gift for you.
You might be thinking, Pastor, why do you keep saying the same thing? Because I want us to live in this reality, okay? So what's our password now? Romans 5:2, right? Capital R, put the 5 right next to the S, and then a colon, and then the 2, and you're good to go. And remember that we now, through faith in Christ, have access to his work in the past, which is justification. We have access to his work in the present, which is sanctification. And we are promised access to his work in the future, which is glorification. And because it's secure, our lives should be characterized with what? With rejoicing, with joy. Not boasting in what we've done, but boasting in what Jesus has done, is doing, and will continue to do in our lives. Amen? We're committed to doing 3 things here at the church. So if you're visiting with us, I want to let you know we use hand motions to say this. We say reaching up, reaching in, and reaching out in the name of Jesus Christ, okay? Are we ready? Are we ready? Oh, that works. Past, present, future, reaching up, reaching in, and reaching out. Okay, there you go. Our 3 for his 3, amen? All right, are we ready? On the count of 3. 1, 2, 3. Reaching up, reaching in, and reaching out in the name of Jesus Christ. People of God, receive this blessing of the Lord from Romans, last chapter, Romans 16, 25 to 20. I told you Romans was going to be amazing. I told you. I tried to tell you. So you got to come back next Sunday as we look at the bottom half of Romans 5, okay? Now to him who is able to establish you in my gospel and proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery hidden for long ages past, but now revealed and made known through the prophetic writings by the command of the eternal God, so that all nations might believe and obey him. To the only wise God be glory forever through Jesus Christ. And all of God's people shouted and said, amen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you all for coming today. Oh, my soul.
like. Ye nations bow, mountains shake at the sound of just one name. Over all, Jesus reigns alone. I know.
Come on.
Ye nations bow, mountains shake at the sound of just one name.